Okay, thank you, Mr. President. So I'd like to start by thanking the Scientific Committee for this invitation, my friend Savas, Surmelis, and Olga Savidou. And I will say, I have to say that I'm a little bit intimidated by what Dr. Darlis just showed you, because I don't have arthroscopic pictures to show you. And I can't really say that I have a big experience in osteochondritis dissecans of the elbow. But nevertheless, I can shove you through a couple of principles. And I will start by saying that why do we use arthroscopy? We're trying to do a minimal trauma. So we're trying to avoid opening the joint up, which means adhesions, and that will create a problem with mobility, or even heterotopic ossification. So it's a good tool in our hands. It's not an easy thing to get into the elbow joint. You have to follow exactly what Dr. Darlis showed you with the portals. And basically what you can do is you can treat, of course, osteochondritis dissecans. As you saw earlier, I'm gonna discuss with you two or three more options. And of course, you can treat the fractures of the radial head, as you saw, capitulum. Not easy, it can be done. Chondropathy of the capitulum, not easy, it can be done. Coronoid fracture, difficult. So basically what you do is you're treating focal defects. So usually the pattern of the pathology is that it's the capitulum of the dominant upper arm. You will see it in athletes who use their elbows a lot. And usually these are athletes of baseball or gymnastics. And we're talking about a microtrauma with repetition, which will affect the subchondral bone. It's gonna lead into microfracture. And through this microfracture mobility, you will have a chondral defect, which means if you leave it like this, soon the patient is gonna run into arthritis. And then well, you have to do open surgery anyway. So when you have this separation and you have these loose bodies, as Dr. Dalis beautifully showed you earlier on, one of the indications of this technique is to just remove them. So what kind of symptoms do we expect? As I said earlier, we're talking about adolescents who are like 10 to 15 years old. And of course, as we all know, when we have loose bodies, what do we expect? Pain, tenderness, swelling, usually in the lateral aspect of the elbow. And when we examine it, we're gonna see that there is a loss of motion, pain, tenderness, and there is a radiocapitular compression test, which is going to be positive, as you see on the right downside of this slide. Of course, we have to make a differential diagnosis. We have to know that it's not an osteochondrosis like Panner's disease, which usually is something that we meet in an age of, at an age of 7 to 12 years old patients, and we know that it's going to heal within a year. So imaging, of course, the first thing that we do as orthopedic surgeons is x-rays. Usually it's gonna be normal, especially in the early stages. We could do a CT scan, which could show us the presence of loose bodies, but of course then we're gonna see something in the X-ray as well. So basically, our basic tool is the MRI, which has a big sensitivity, as you can see, for unstable lesions, but small specificity. So what do we do? When we, at the early stage, when the lesion is stable, well, we could recommend to the patient to stop introducing repetitive stress on the elbow and, of course, observe. We don't need to go and act directly through an operation. If the lesion is not resolved within 3 to 6 months, then we should go into the idea of surgical treatment. What is this surgical treatment? Well, if you want to do a small trauma and it's easy for you to take, let's say, the loose bodies out, well, arthroscopic management is a method of choice. You can, as you saw earlier by Dr. Darlis, you can do debridement, you can remove the loose bodies, and of course, then, if you think that it's something that it's easy in your hands, and it's not, you can try to replace that piece of osteochondral, that osteochondral piece, with an autologous osteochondral graft. Of course, you need to follow the principle of grafting. And what's that? You have to be vertical to the surface where you're putting it, number one. Number two, you have to take such a graft which is going to cover the whole surface. It's not always easy. It's difficult to have congruent and to have, let's say, to imitate the round surface of the capitulum, but at least you're going to have cartilage in this position and you can avoid arthritis. So other surgical techniques besides the osteochondral grafting, as I said earlier, is debridement. You can take the loose bodies out. You can do drilling, as you heard earlier on. You can do microfracture if it's not very deep, because whether you do drilling or whether you're going to try to replace it, it depends on the size and the dimension and the depth. So if it's not very deep, as you can see on the picture on the right, you can do microfracture and you can produce a fibrin clot, which is going to replace that cartilage there with fibrous tissue. Is it going to last? No. But you're going to have a patient with less symptoms. So basically, what you can do is, when you have grade 1 lesions, you observe, or if it's really symptomatic, you could go arthroscopically. You don't open the joint, minimal invasive. You can do drilling. When we have lesions grade 2, we can debride the cartilage up to the healthy tissue, and it will still, let's say, last a little bit longer, and the patient's going to be symptom-free. If we have a loose fragment, then basically what it's proposed to be done, and I agree with it, is you turn the grade 3 into grade 4 lesion, and basically you resect the fragment, because you don't want a joint which cannot be moved because of blocking. And then when we have grade 5 lesions, of course, we remove the loose bodies, we try abrasion, chondroplasty, whatever is easy in our hands, so as not to produce any damage to the patient. Because I have to remind you that basically, when you take a piece out of the body and you put it back in, you do produce iatrogenic injury, and you have to choose where you're going to get it from the knee. Usually it's from the knee. So your patient, it's probable that he's going to have problems with his knee. So, complications, of course, this is what we're afraid of when we are, pushing our arthroscopes around the elbow because of the nerves. You're afraid of damaging the radial nerve or the posterior interosseous nerve or the ulnar nerve. If sometimes we have a radial nerve palsy because of extravasation of the fluid, we can understand that it's going to be something transient and it's going to come back after 1 or 2 months. Infection, it's the percentage of infection in arthroscopy is really, really low. And of course, in the beginning, when we don't have the feeling how we're going to get into the joint, we can produce articular damage. Posteriorly now, what we do is we can keep a splint 90 degrees for 2-3 days. And then start as soon as possible range of motion as it can be tolerated by the patient. And of course, it's better to start with passive physical activity and passive motion and go into active after that. What about the results? Well, the literature tells us that the results are really good with returning to sports, with all these three methods. So depending on the grade, you can choose the method you can expect, of course, to have better results than to have loose bodies in the elbow. So in conclusion, it's a method of minimal trauma. We do achieve fast mobilization, and it is an effective way to restore cartilage defects. And of course, it does preserve the joint. Thank you very much for your attention.